Welcome to Love and Money, the podcast of Prosperity ULLC, where we discuss what's happening to us, and what can we do about it. In this episode, we will discuss Bernie Sanders, Al Capone, another new flip phone, Dababy, and Antonio Brown. But before we go in, let's take a moment to invest in the brand.
Sign up to become a member of the Bard Society. With your subscription, you gain access to exclusive book content and apparel and accessories that no one else has. Become a member. Become exclusive. Purchase all Prosperity ULLC books, apparel, and accessories at Prosperity Living, the merchandise store of the Prosperity ULLC brand. There's something in it for everyone, spanning categories like apparel, clothing accessories, electronic accessories, home and travel, and bag and tote. Invest in Prosperity Living. Live in prosperity.
And we're back. Welcome to Temperature Check. This is our current events segment of Love and Money. The coronavirus is surging in China. Right now, there's a tally of about 40,000 incidents of this virus. You know, every truth is a half truth, you know, and you can't, you know, you can only believe half of what you hear, basically. And I think there's more to this thing, this coronavirus thing, the fact that it's surging in the world and it's surging in media. China has been for many years, China has been an economic threat to us. And I just don't see too much coincidence of them undergoing a virus surge. You know, we've seen throughout history different tactics of warfare, and I don't want to implicate anything, but I'm just too smart to just think that this is a coincidence. But Bernie Sanders is a front runner for the Democrats right now after New Hampshire. As I'm recording this, they've been indicating that Mayor Bloomberg, former New York Mayor Bloomberg, is surging right now. He has the money to surge. I think he's the evil twin of Donald Trump. You know, he has the money, but he's very humble and pragmatic. Whereas, you know, Donald Trump is a little all over the place. You know, he sways back and forth and caters to whoever he needs to cater to in order to get what he wants from them. And that's a very narcissistic trait, but it does lead to a lot of practical success. You can buy Al Capone's bulletproof 1928 Cadillac for $1 million. I think it may be, I didn't look too deep into it, but I think it's up for auction or something like that. Now, I didn't know they bulletproofed cars back in those days. But, you know, we all know who Al Capone is. Al Capone is kind of like a hero figure. We glorify, we romanticize gangsters in this culture because this country was built on gangsters. I don't want to go too left field, but you know, before slavery, there were prisoners, European prisoners brought here to work the fields. So yeah, you could take that for what it's worth. But yeah, they had bulletproof Cadillacs in the 20s. That's interesting. Your credit score might fall a little bit. They're doing a new thing now, and it's with the readjustment, it'll affect your credit score. So even if you pay your bills on time. So if you're in bad standing, you know, you may want to get on top of things. I know, I remember for the longest, my credit score was so bad, I used to just hate looking at it. I used to just ignore it. It's like, it's not going to get any better. I'm still broke. It's not, you know, I still owe like a ton of bills. But, you know, now that life has gotten a little bit better, I have been able to take a much more proactive approach to my economic standing. And it is very rewarding. It is very gratifying. And, you'd be surprised the benefits that come with a healthy credit score. But I'm still scarred, and I still believe credit cards are the devil. And I figured that out when I was 19. But that's another story for another podcast, right? Electric vehicles outsold manual transmissions by 50% in 2019. So people clown this Tesla guy, but he's doing his thing. He's out here in these streets selling these cars like hotcakes. I just have to wrap my head around a fully electric vehicle, because I've been so indoctrinated and brainwashed on gasoline fuel powered vehicles. You know, it's just like, how dependable is the vehicle? Will it cut off in the rain? it's an electric vehicle. Will it shock me? You know, how electric is it? Like, how does this electricity work in my vehicle? What's the battery life? Like, how far can I go on it? How often can I come across a charger to charge my vehicle up? You know, these are valid questions, but I just got to wrap my head around it. And I like the concept. I think I'm going to test drive an electric car soon as I get home. Yeah, I'm going to test drive an electric vehicle. I need to get over myself. I need to get out of my own way. Amazon has great deals on Apple AirPods and Echo Buds, and Amazon Echo Buds right now. There's a Twitter that I go to for cool deals that I've gotten a couple cool deals off of. They're called Fat Kid Deals, I think. Yeah, it's a really cool Twitter. They post a lot, so be careful how you choose to follow them. But I don't necessarily follow them because they post so much, because they just flood my timeline. I have their Twitter saved, and I check it often. And it's very good. It's very informative, and you get the hookup. You really get the hookup. They give you like promo codes, and the promo codes actually work sometimes. You know, it's hit or miss. You know, sometimes they work. Sometimes, you know, the promo code may have passed and they deactivated it or something. But you will get the hookup. You will get that low price you've been looking for that you wouldn't be able to find just searching Amazon straight up. They'll give you like an exclusive link, and you really get the hookup. It's cool. The Galaxy S20 is raising the bar. For those of you who are not iPhone addicted, the Galaxy S20 is supposed to be like just better than the iPhone in every category. Which is cool, but it doesn't necessarily move me per se as an iPhone addict, as a confessed iPhone addict. But I just wish any phone that's better than the iPhone, any kind of Android that's better than the iPhone, just put an Apple iOS on it, please. Just do me that one solid. A former friend of Lonnie Love snitched on her and talked about the emails that she had to get Tamar Braxton kicked off the show The Real. Lonnie Love is kind of, she's become the Kobe of that show. You have like Whoopi Goldberg is the Kobe of The View. And when I say the Kobe, what I mean is they build the team around them. You know, when Kobe was in his prime in the early 2000s, in the kind of like the in the late 90s and early 2000s, when Kobe was in his prime, Kobe would, you know, throw his temper tantrums and, you know, roll on the floor like a 3-year-old, and they would trade players to get him to play with who he wanted, you know. And so and you know, the, and they would kind of manufacture a championship team for him, you know. And I think that's the same situation that they have going with Lonnie Love and The Real, with Whoopi and The View. Now, do I watch these shows? Not necessarily, simply because they don't appeal to my demographic. You know, I mean, I'm a, you know, Lonnie, when you look at these TV shows and who they appeal to, now it's so, sometimes it can be a mimicked identity. So if like the host is a man, it appeals to men. If the host is a woman, it appeals to women. If the host is black, it appeals to black people, so on and so forth. But you know, other cases, you know, like Michael Strahan, you know, he's appealing to women in some fashion, you know. I don't know any guy. I don't personally know any guy who's into watching daytime television with Michael Strahan on it. I'm not in those circles. I'm sorry, but Lonnie Love appeals to a demographic, a mimicked demographic that, you know, has the availability to tune into her show. You know, she's a middle-aged black woman. She uses a quote unquote urban vernacular. I hate that word. You know, she has a high sense of humor, and you know, she doesn't use big words, you know, and women of that particular demographic may not necessarily be as educated to understand those big words, so they can relate to her character a lot more on that show. And so they're going to build around her, and Tamar being Tamar, you know, she's a fireball, you know, and I guess Lonnie Love may have felt like she was too much. She was stealing her shine. And, you know, we dog people for doing this kind of thing. We're of tearing others down to pull themselves up. But this is, you know, not everybody's that righteous. And this is clearly evident of human nature. You know, some people are just wired that way to be insecure and tear others down to pull themselves up, you know, and be afraid that someone's presence and just their energy and aura is going to steal their shine. So this is a great lesson, a cautionary tale. Dababy is having Dababy, and so apparently he's been cheating on his current child's mother, and it has another one on the way. This where do I begin with Dababy? I'm proud of his success. I can't say that I've watched him from the beginning because I don't really follow these newer artists and these newer Southern artists, you know, but I did like his hit song. The one where he was just like, yeah, yeah, I do what I want. Suge. Yeah, Suge. That's what it was. I like that. So I like the energy on that song. I like his energy. I like his style. You know, I just wish he would stay out of the negative media. And then it's kind of like, and I think that's how the media does you. You know, it's like a snowball. You know, they try to fishing for what new story they can come up with next, and they'll take whatever you give them. Like, oh, the baby picked his nose. Like, look at the baby picking his nose. Oh, snap. Oh, my God. You know? And I just wish somebody could reach out to him. I just wish he could, like, just fall back and then just, you know, just put out fire. Like, I'm hearing more tabloid than I am hearing music. And he puts out great. He does great music, you know? So, yeah. I mean, okay, he got a girl pregnant. Okay, that's his business. Now, let's hear some music. Rap about it. Rap about getting that other girl pregnant. You know, put it in a song or make a song about it. You know, whatever. But yeah, we don't need the press. Also heard about him, you know, beating the pants off of a club owner for shorting them 10 grand. You know, And a lot of people are complaining. And then that's another thing that's striking too. That's another reason I want him to fall back, is because, you know, the higher you go up, the bigger the target is on your back. And so it's important for him to just chill out. City girl Caresha celebrates her birthday by asking for fans to Cash App her $5. She's one of the hottest female rappers right now. So like asking for $5 on your birthday, you know, I guess with her status and where she's supposedly supposed to be in her fame and stardom, it would seem like just very, very cheap and unbecoming of her to be asking for her fans to give her $5 on Cash App. So it could be two sides of a coin. It could be just like a marketing hustle, you know, where she just said, fuck, you know, like she's just that, she lives her rhymes, like pay me, you know what I'm saying? Give me my money. Or it could just be that, you know, they may not be as prosperous as they may seem, you know. They signing deal after deal and they having, they at event after event, but where's the money going, maybe, you know? So it could be a good look, it could be a bad look, but knowing these kinds of girls, they have no shame and they're not afraid to ask, you know, because if you don't ask, you don't receive. Dame Dash wins his lawsuit. He had several lawsuits out on him right now. I think they're just trying to. When you see little petty lawsuits like this, it's really just to slow someone down and really tarnish them and really just being to troll. It's very trollish when you see little miniature lawsuits like this. But this one lawsuit he overcame was one about a movie deal where they were arguing. Don't quote me, but they were arguing the rights on the deal or who created it or who had the rights to it or something like that. And basically, they were persecuting him and saying, you know, and saying that he has no ownership or something like that. And the court was like, well, there's nothing to stand on this. There's no grounds on it. So we have to dismiss it. So you don't really win lawsuits. You either get charged or you either get convicted or you get dismissed or acquitted. You know, well, conviction, that's criminal court. But you know what I mean? You know, you either the case falls through or it just gets dismissed. But they call the dismissal a win for the defendant. You know what I mean? So, yeah, Dame Dash won his lawsuit. Kudos to Dame Dash. It's been a slow, slow week in sports. Very dry. Nothing hitting. You know, every time football season ends, it's like there's a vacuum in the world, in the universe, you know? And, yeah, the black hole just sucks up everything. And then there's no news in sports. But Antonio Brown has found a change of heart. I guess he felt he thought the NFL was gonna drop to their knees and worship him at his feet, and that wasn't the case. He needs to realize that the NFL is bigger than him. A lot of, especially like these wide receivers, these diva wide talents. They're uber talented, but they're divas, and they end up stepping on their feet a lot, trying to get the world to bow down to them, and to their own hubris, they tarnish their legacies and, you know, ruin things for themselves. Antonio Brown, just like many other, you know, highly talented black receivers, have really, you know, really been a detriment to themselves. You saw this with Terrell Owens, and I really don't think it's them. I think it's their agents and their crew and so on and so forth, and these people putting batteries in their backs while they have these multi-million dollar mansions and multiple children with multiple women that they can't afford. You know, it's just rough. It's like a slow train wreck. We saw this with Chad Ochocinco Johnson. Soon as he got with that Evelyn Lozada woman, I just knew it was the beginning of the end. I was just like, dude, what are you doing? What are you doing? You know what this woman's about, and you just keep, you see the burning building and you just walk right into it. It's like you're a moth drawn to a flame. You know what I'm saying? Like, the head ain't that good. It's not that, it's never that good. It's never that good to end your career. I mean, I know you're walking away with a pension, you know. Now, as far as Antonio Brown, shoot, how long has he been in the league? I haven't really followed the NFL like that, but he may be getting a pension. He may have screwed that up. You know, how much real money does he really have? Because the NFL hasn't been known to really pay out like that. You know what I'm saying? The NBA has been known for that. Major League Baseball, woo. They pay their players. Golf, you can't argue with that. Golf pays their players. But the NFL, I don't know. The average player in the NFL makes over six figures, over 100,000. The average player in the NBA makes over $1 million. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, what? And then you have the different factors, you know. There's only 13 players on a basketball team as opposed to 50 something on a football team. So, yeah. So how much money really does Antonio Brown have? And I guess with the lifestyle that he was living, maybe that was his change of heart. The money's running out. But he hasn't been Floyd Mayweather with it, I suppose. But yet and still, that money. So he apologized to Ben Roethlisberger. I'm talking in circles. He apologizes to Ben Roethlisberger, writes him a letter. He was in cahoots with the Raiders, the Steelers, and the Patriots. He used to play for the Steelers. I think then he went to New England for a hot little minute, didn't work out, and then he was talking to the Raiders. But he, I don't know what it is with this guy. Like, he just can't. And then, you know, and then I heard his story on when LeBron did his little TV show on HBO for a hot little minute. And, you know, he mentioned that he was like a sixth round draft pick, you know. So this is a guy who really had to fight and claw his way to the top. And he's throwing it all away for what? Like, for what, really? And then he has his allegations with his ex-wife. You know, I think those, when it, you know, it's always convenient how, like, when you're in some sort of dispute with an institution or a corporation, that somewhere, some way, somehow, some sort of sexual allegation always comes up. You know what I mean? Like, you can just smell it. You can just hear it coming. You know, you can hear the footsteps. You know, it's just in the background. Just sexual allegation, sexual allegation, sexual allegation. And when it comes, it's a stain that never, ever comes off. You know what I mean? Never comes off. But I feel like time should change. I feel like people should really roll their eyes when they see things like this. And I think that was the case, because when I heard about the whole sexual allegation with the battery, assault, whatever, with the ex-wife, I rolled my eyes. I don't know about the rest of the media, but I did. You know, and hopefully that stuff comes and goes. But whatever. Whatever. The NBA All-Star Game is this weekend. It's happening in Chicago. Ew. Chicago. But oh well. You know, the young ladies will be in full attendance regardless. I was thinking it was going to be in Miami or something like that. You know, they had the Super Bowl in Miami. And then what else they had in Miami at the same time? Some other big event. They had the Super Bowl and then Miami Carnival, you know. So they had the All-Star Game in the same month. Wow, like that would have been a lot. That would have been big. But Miami is not everything. Whew, please don't get it twisted. Miami is, You know, a lot of these big cities are just classy ghettos. They really are. They're classy ghettos. They're expensive garbage cans. Speaking of expensive garbage can, I saw a garbage can for $80. I saw a garbage can, like, I spent $80 on a garbage can. That shit better throw its own trash out. I don't know. I don't know. Am I too simple? Am I too country? Am I too ghetto? But I don't know. I just don't like the idea of spending $80 on a trash receptacle. I just won't. I can't. It's bad enough. I spent almost whatever. Anyway. But the NBA All-Star game is this weekend in Chicago. But you know, Chicago is a very bad, is a basketball city. So we're here for it. Damian Lillard is missing the game due to injury, which sucks, because, you know, the streets love Damian Lillard. He shot a dope buzzer beater last year to knock out, I think it was Golden State, don't quote me, but that's mainly what I remember him for, and he does whoop my behind in NBA 2K, so, yeah, he's a pretty great player. He would have made the game very, very interesting. But this year, it's going to be, once again, Team Giannis. I like to say Giannis. There's a G there. Why is a G silent? But I say Giannis. It's my show. I'm going to say Giannis. Team Giannis versus Team LeBron. Giannis Antetokounmpo was criticized for picking Joel Embiid as his first pick. Giannis Antetokounmpo is of direct first generation African descent, Nigerian per se. Joel Embiid is also and indigenous to the continent. He was born in Africa, and I don't quote me on which country. I have been noticing within the past 5 years a high influx of African direct African players into the NBA, and I think this is interesting. It's intriguing. I remember a long time ago, all the listeners have to be old enough to remember this. There was a movie called The Air Up There, and it was about a white guy, you know, those white savior movies. He visited some village in Africa where these guys were like uber physically gifted, and they were just doing things at will that people have to train years and years to do. And he was like, oh my gosh, these guys are amazing. They need to be in the NBA. And all I remember, I was a small kid when this movie came out, but all I remember was one of the characters, one of the tribesmen, saying Nuba. And he was like, oh, what? Nuba, what's that? He's like, oh, the NBA. You know what I mean? So yeah, when I saw that years ago, I knew where the future was headed. So this, I'm so not surprised. And I'm so not surprised that Giannis is going to look out for his own. You know, he's going to look out for his own. I remember Charlemagne the God, the radio personality on The Breakfast Club on Power 105 in New York. He said, I don't blame other cultures for looking out for each other, for nepotizing each other, so to speak. You know, I don't blame Italians for looking out for Italians. I don't blame Chinese for looking out for Chinese. You know, the same way they do it, we should do it too. And it was very striking at the time when I first heard him say that, because I wasn't ready to hear it. You know, I was just like, dang, you know, it's one of those things where it hurts, but you know, it's the truth hurts, but you know, it's right. You know what I'm saying? And that was the case. So stay tuned for our next segment, which is going to be the main course. I have a good one for you. Okay. I have a good one for you. This will enlighten you. This will really, hopefully it'll change your life. But yeah, I digress. Just stay here and invest in the brand. All right. I got you.
Sign up to become a member of the Bard Society. With your subscription, you gain access to exclusive book content and apparel and accessories that no one else has. Become a member. Become exclusive. Purchase all Prosperity ULLC books, apparel, and accessories at Prosperity Living, the merchandise store of the Prosperity ULLC brand. There's something in it for everyone, spanning categories like apparel, clothing accessories, electronic accessories, home and travel, and bag and tote. Invest in Prosperity Living. Live in Prosperity.
Welcome back. It's now time for our final segment. This segment is called The Main Course. The Main Course. This is our discussion segment. Today's topic is there any such thing as a conservative non-Trump supporter? Yes. Now, please don't tune me out. Don't click this off. Trust me. This is going to be good. Ever since I started this podcast, I've never really paid attention to current events like this before I started this podcast. And paying attention to current events and doing all this research, not all of this research, it's not a whole lot, but just skimming around and just looking around and seeing what's going on in the world has really, really opened my eyes, to where the world is headed and to where I'm headed, you know? Yeah, it's really enlightened me to myself and given me a stronger identity as to my relation to the world around me. You know, I kind of lived in my own world until I educated myself on the world. I spent a lot of time educating myself on myself, but now that I'm educating myself on the world, I have a different tool in my tool shed. And I feel like if you pay attention, if you stay tuned in this podcast, you will too. So I saved the definition of a conservative for last because that's what this is about. But I want to build up to it. Okay. So first, let's break down what is a liberal. All right. Because when we talk about a bipartisanship politics, it doesn't really boil down to Democrats and Republicans. Like, it's Democrats and Republicans are what's on paper, but when it comes to opinions and beliefs and stances, it really boils down to conservatives and liberals in this day and age. Back in the day, yeah, that's what it was about, Democrats and Republicans, but now it's become a lot more complicated, or not even complicated, but just there's different brackets to it now. So a liberal is a person who is open to new behavior or opinions and willing to discard traditional values. Someone who is favorable to or respectful of individuals' rights and freedoms. Now that's the key right there. In a political context, it's favoring maximum individual liberty in political and social reform. Now, I like the favorable and respectful of individual rights and freedoms because I feel like that's what we all should be, you know. So in reading these things, I was trying to find my place. Okay, am I conservative? Am I liberal? You know, and so yeah. And then on my Facebook timeline, people were calling themselves independent. So I'm like, okay, what is an independent? An independent is variously defined as a voter who votes for candidates on issues rather than on the basis of political ideology or partisanship. I like that. You know, I think that's how all people should vote. I think we should vote for issues rather than partisanship. You know, it's like, okay, you Republican, but your views and your opinions line up with mine. You know what I'm saying? Maybe not wholeheartedly, maybe not 100%, not each and every one, but for the most part, I could see myself living under your administration. You know what I mean? And that's what it really boils down to. Can you see yourself living under this person's administration? I have people quoting Yes, I've been. So when I posed the question on Facebook, is there any such thing as a conservative non-Trump supporter? One says, yes, I've been called a fiscal Republican and a social Democrat. So maybe I'm just independent. And maybe you are. Maybe you are. A big argument in that thread came up about the stop and frisk spotlight. And it's ironic, as I tuned into CNN tonight, it was brought up about, you know, Bloomberg, who was the mayor of New York, and New York, which was like pretty much the hub of stop and frisk when it came to law enforcement. And what, you know, what effect did stop and frisk have on crime? But however, what effect did it have on the social quality of life for Black people in New York City? Was I ever stopped and frisked? No, I was stopped one time as a teenager, but I was never really, you know, I wasn't about that life. You know, I played sports. I was into girls. I was, you know, I had a mom and dad at home who both worked a job. You know what I'm saying? So I wasn't in the streets like that. I wasn't carrying a gun. I didn't live in an area that was heavily high crime area. So, you know, there wasn't really much reason for cops to stop and frisk me. But I do remember, the heartache and pain that the stop and frisk law caused, and the rejoicing of it when it got lifted. It was a two-sided coin, because some people liked it because it dropped crime. The murder, it cut the murder rate in half. It did a lot for the city and the quality of life there. And it kind of made way. It was one of those laws, those laws that made way for gentrification. I think Bloomberg kind of piggybacked on what Giuliani had already established, you know. But some people, the people who applaud stop and frisk, you know, they look at the younger generation as like crybabies. And this goes into the cancel culture sensitivity, you know. They looked at the younger generation as crybabies because they don't really understand or see what these harsh laws, how these harsh laws are actually saving them, you know. But what the younger generation is quote unquote crying about is how harassing it is, how harassive it is to be stopped and frisked. Now, you know, I don't like to be stopped. I don't like to be stopped at all. Doing anything, you know, let me not digress. But so I could only imagine, you know, what it's like walking down the street, you know, minding my business, and then to be stopped by police, let alone just be stopped, you know. So yeah, stop and frisk, you know, that's another topic. But you know, some conservatives may roll with it. Mitt Romney and John McCain serve as great examples of conservative non-Trump supporters. You know, these are guys who, you know, yeah, they play the right, and when I say the right, what I mean is, I mean conservative. When you hear, oh, the right this and the left that, the right is conservative, the left is liberal. That's what they mean, pretty much. But yeah, they serve the right, but they don't serve Trump. And I like that about them. I like that about them. I respect that. Here's what one person on my timeline had to say about Trump. Trump is the poster boy for conservatism. He is everything conservatives have embraced for decades rolled into one. He personifies all they believe, allow, and contribute to. While Trump is the head conservative in charge, those who don't support him would be declaring themselves independents. So the poster boy for conservatives, that's a little extreme. That's a little extra. You know what I'm saying? That's a little absolute. I don't think it's that absolute. The poster boy for conservatives. I think Trump is the poster boy for a lot of bigot white people. I think that's all he is, the poster boy for. And you know, he has no allegiance to anyone or to anything that he says. Like, I just wish people would wake up and stop drinking the Kool-Aid, like, and just see right through these tactics. He's a textbook narcissist, you know, but I digress again. Yeah, I think he just reminds a lot of people of their bigot dad or grandfather at the dinner table, you know, while their wife fetches the beer with the black eye. You know what I'm saying? He just reminds those people of them. So, yeah, it's a little extreme, but I get it. I get why someone would think that, because a lot of the hardcore conservatives are really hardcore, you know, Trump. You know what I mean? He's their superhero. He's their spirit animal. But one would think, as threatening as Trump may be to a lot of the disenfranchised demographics, do white people feel oppressed in this day and age? That's an important question, because everyone claims and believes and is so sold on Trump being such a bigot and such a racist. But is the playing field balanced? Are white people being oppressed? Do white people feel oppressed under this administration? That's a good question to ask. Why is being black in America synonymous with oppression and poverty? Why have we drank the media's Kool-Aid on these things? Like, there are no black people who are successful and powerful and prominent, you know, and opulent. Aside from being athletes and entertainers, you know, there are no powerful black people in corporate America. There are no powerful black people in, you know, other institutions and other realms other than sports and entertainment. Are there? You know what I mean? Like, why is this so synonymous? That's one thing that always struck me throughout my life, really. And why do we always have to compare the quality of our life to that of whites? Oh, white people have this, so we should have that too. White people have this privilege, so we should have that too. White people got this going for them, we should have that too. Like, we don't need that. We don't need that. What we need is what's for us. Why are Republicans synonymous with racism or with being racist? Someone's Republican, so they're racist. You know, I think it's unfair. It's important. Now, when we talk about the two parties, it's important to know, to understand the history. We have to remember, we have to never forget, right? We never forget slavery, right? If we're never going to forget slavery, we should also never forget that it was the Republicans who freed the slaves. Now, how the Republican Party changed, the Republican and Democrat parties changed in their stances after World War II, because the Democrats, the Southern white Democrats were adverse to the progressivism of the Republicans after World War II, because they wanted to get into big industry and big corporations and things like this. Because you got to remember, this was, you know, this is the 1940s. So, like, you know, the Ford, the car, the automobile was a big thing back then. It was a new thing. And, you know, just coming up, you know, a big industry in Detroit and, you know, General Motors and all of that. That was a big boom after World War II. And, you know, the Republicans were all about that back then. And the Southern white Democrats, who were for slavery, were against all of this progressivism. And so from World War II all the way up until, you know, the 80s and 90s, you know, the Democrats became, don't quote me. I think it's the other way around. Yeah, Southern whites who were for slavery started leaving the Democratic Party because the Democratic Party wanted to be more progressive. There you go. Yeah, see. But I had to research this. And yeah, the Democratic Party wanted to be more progressive. So, and then the Republicans wanted to stay conservative. But prior to that, during the slave era, it was the Republicans who wanted to free the slaves because they were for the progressive North. But yeah, don't quote me. Don't confuse me. So, like the parties sway with the times. They change, they shift. And so it's important to not vote by your party, but vote by the issues. Vote by the issues that matter to you. Why are black voters synonymous with the Democratic Party? Just because you black means you're a Democrat? That's not fair either, you know? One thing I've realized is that the more educated I've become, like, because before I used to vote Democrat just because. And I was brainwashed. I used to, you know, drink the Kool-Aid. Oh, I'm black, so I'm going to vote Democrat. I literally used to think that way. And I know there's a lot of you probably listening to this who probably still think that way, you know. But as I gotten older and more mature and more wise and more educated and learned how to think with a skeptical mind and question everything and understand that every truth is a half truth, you know, that there's more to it, you know what I mean? And start, yeah, the more questions I asked, the more I've kind of re-identified myself, sort of. I've just gotten smarter. And, you know, the Bible says people perish for a lack of knowledge. You know, knowledge is the knowledge reigns supreme, you know. But let me not digress. Let me not. I think when it comes to black people, to the black vote, a lot of times it's always the lesser of two evils. You know, you're not really for either of them, but you feel like this person, it will hurt a lot less if you vote for this person as opposed to that person. So a lot of black folks feel that way. Now let's get into the meat and potatoes. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? All right. What is conservatism? What is conservatism? The definition of a conservative would be holding to traditional attitudes and values and cautious about change or innovation, typically in relation to politics or religion. Now, me, I've never been the traditional type. I've never been the one to hold on or adhere to any kind of, you know, I've never been cautious. I've always been for innovation and progression as long as it provides some sort of functionality and practicality. You know, is it practical? Can this be done? Can it be done in an efficient way? And what is the result of it? What is, you know, how does this make things better? What is the function of it? So yeah, being traditional and all that kind of stuff, that's where I kind of step out of the Venn diagram circle of conservatism. You know, being that, just holding on to tradition, and when it comes to politics and religion, like whatever, you know, I mean, like, if that's the thing that always confused me or left me in a fog about traditional people. It's like, why are you holding on to the tradition? What purpose? Like I said, what is your tradition practical and functional? You know, are you doing it because it's making your quality of life better for you and the people around you? Or are you doing it because it just makes you feel good about yourself and it has some sort of sentiment to your memory? You know what I mean? Like what is the real hang up? What are you holding on to, really? You know? And so, yeah. However, a lot of conservatives feel as though black people are too victim minded. And that I do agree with. These are the tenets I've been cackling at for the past 10 years plus on YouTube, back since I started in 2008, since I started recording videos in 2008, is, you know, this woe is me mentality about how the man and the system and the blah, 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 and the blah, blah, blah. One thing I've always been saying about the system is that the system is not for or against anyone. The system is not designed for or designed against anyone. It's simply designed to work. And the people who it's working for are the people who are working the system, you know? And the only way you can work the system is if you learn the system. Like I said, knowledge reigns supreme, knowledge over everything. You know, so if you got to learn the game in order to play it, because if you don't play, you can't win. And that's what the system is about. And so the victimhood that a lot of black people take, in some cases, it may be warranted, but in most cases, it's not. In most cases, it's not. Am I blind to racism? Fuck no. You know, pardon my French. You know what I mean? But because one thing I have full understanding of is institutionalized racism. You know, racism that's been structured where there's an entire financial corporation built around racism. You know what I'm saying? That I do understand, you know, like the prison industrial complex. You know, I get that, you know, but for the most part, you know, I do believe that there is a little bit of bootstrapping that is necessary. You hear a lot of conservatives say that as well. Oh, you got to pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Now, some people don't have the quote unquote boots to pull themselves to strap themselves up with. And I get that. I get that. But for the most part, if there's a will, there's a way. And if you really want to get out of your situation, you're going to get out of it. You know what I mean? Some way, somehow, you know, you'll find the means. And, you know, some way, somehow, I do believe that as well. You know, yeah, things, you know, the system is fucked up. The world is fucked up. Your situation is fucked up. But if you scratch and claw and bite and seek knowledge, knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. There's no way around that. A lot of conservatives debate capitalism versus welfare, you know, whereas the capitalist side of it would be the bootstrap argument, you know, just pull yourself up and, you know, get out of your situation. Whereas the welfare argument would be, you know, we have to help these people out. We have to, if we make a dollar, we got to give them a penny. You know what I mean? And, you know, a lot of conservatives feel like that's not fair. You know, welfare isn't fair. They call it welfare, but it's not fair. You know, I always believe that it's a government's duty to take care of its poor, because you're only as strong as your weakest link, you know. And what good is you thriving and being successful and you know, being so wealthy if the people in the same community, because we're all one, I feel like we're all one big community at the end of the day. And if the same people in your community are struggling, then you're not wealthy. You're not wealthy if they're struggling. So there's a certain dance you have to do with it. A lot of, especially black conservatives, agree that fatherless homes are the main virus in the black community. Fatherless homes are the virus of the black community. The tearing down of the black family starts with the fatherless home. And as someone who's worked with children in the past, someone who has children, someone who's dealt with a lot of family drama. Like I said, I grew up with both of my parents, you know what I mean? But I was in a single parent situation for a long time. I can attest to that. Scientific studies may differ or oppose that notion that a fatherless home isn't a cause and effect. They say it may be a correlation, but it's not necessarily a cause and effect. But I say, fuck that. It's a cause. It's a cause. A lot of these kids out here that don't know how to act, that can't sit still or can't conduct themselves in a classroom or in a school environment, you know, bouncing off the walls and all this other stuff. And, you know, can't complete a decent education, can't be consistent to anything, or don't know how to be men, have no discipline, have no kind of manners, or whatever the case may be. It's because they're missing a father. Point blank, period. And, you know, only men can raise men. And I know these single mothers don't want to hear it, but go ahead, try to teach me how to be a woman. You know what I'm saying? Can I teach you how to be a woman? Exactly. So what makes you think you could teach a young boy how to be a man? You know what I'm saying? So yeah, take that to the bank for what it's worth. Is oppression isolated or interconnected? So are like oppressive structures and oppressive rules, you know, set in place, are they so if you feel oppressed, if you feel like a certain system is oppressing you, is that connected to every other system that's oppressing every other people? This is something to think about, you know. Like, let's say, for instance, the heavy, heavy drug laws of the crack era, right? When I researched this and I looked into this, you know, we all now in this day and age, we realize that the government was funding the crack era. They were weren't actually funding crack. They were funding coke. They were buying coke, bringing it into the country and, you know, giving it to black drug dealers to peddle off into the streets, in order for, South American rebel, militaries to fight against drug lords and communist drug lords of their day. We know this now. We didn't know it back then, but the government was then in turn tacking on heavy prison sentences on very small, minuscule amounts of crack and not coke. Because, you know, wealthy white people were using coke while, you know, poor black people in the ghettos were selling and using crack, because crack was cheaper and it was remanufactured and it was cheaper to sell into the hoods. And so they were putting heavier sentences on crack as opposed to coke. But it just so happened that more black people were selling crack as opposed to coke, as opposed to white people selling coke. So a lot of black folks, a lot of black men were being incarcerated for decades, for decades at a time. You know what I mean? And it was, you know, highly punitive, and it was unfair. It seemed unfair. It seemed irrational. But at the time, you know, the media had propagandized, if that's a word, that crack was such an epidemic. However, they were the ones financing the epidemic, but they were calling it an epidemic in the media. So this is how twisted and institutionalized this, you know, this has become. But I think in the grand scheme of things, I think what the government was doing was plugging holes in a dam. They were saying to themselves, oh shit, we fucked up. We need to stop this. We need to pull this back. You know, so they started. So this was their way of clamping down on it and trying to clean up, so to speak. But, you know, the cat has been out the bag for some time now. We know the game. But anyway, either or, we all want the same thing. We all want a boot to pull our straps up by at the end of the day. And it's, you know, high politics, you know, high national politics are cool, are good to focus in on. But if we really want to make an impact, I think it's important that we focus in on our local politics. And that's something that I will be working on myself personally. I think this is trying to identify myself as a conservative or a liberal or an independent has really opened my eyes now that I have a knowledge upon myself, I can now have a knowledge on my world. And that's what I think that's really going to change my life. I think I always used to think politics was an old people thing, and you know, because you always see old people go hard about politics, but there's a reason they see something that we younger folks, you know, don't or didn't. And now that I'm getting older, I'm starting to see what they see. I'm starting to see that, yeah, I really have a finger in, a hand in this matter. And, you know, I can really do something about, you know, my life to some degree through these politics, you know. It's really enlightened and enriched my perspective. And I think it can do the same for you if you follow this podcast. But this is that's just the topic for today. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for tuning in to the very end. I hope you learned something. I know I did. And that concludes our show. And we would like to thank you for tuning in to Prosperity U LLC. And remember to invest in the brand.